Hello guys, my name is Mr. Mrzenski and let's talk today about Angular dependency injection. Initially, I was preparing a video about resolution modifiers like host, self, skip self and so on, which I mentioned in my previous video about top 5 Angular interview questions, but I have quickly realized that it is quite hard to explain this without knowing how the dependency injection mechanism works in Angular. And the second problem is that this topic, dependency injection in Angular, is just too big to be able to briefly explain it in 3-5 minutes. So I decided to create a separate video where I will explain the dependency injection mechanism. And in next videos, we will already talk more about resolution modifiers and another dependency injection features. So stay here, subscribe, and we're getting started. All right, dependency injection. What is that? So Angular docs says dependency injection is a coding pattern in which class asks for dependencies from external sources rather than creating them itself. Well, good to know, but first, why do we need it? Well, the main reason of dependency injection is to avoid the hard dependencies between classes. And the decoupling of object creation from using of this object enables you to replace dependencies without changing the class which is using them. Okay, what does it mean for us? Well, I'm pretty sure that every one of you knows how to create and inject services. So we have a service called user service, as example, which we inject in some component. And what happens then? Kind of magic, right? But actually happens quite a straightforward thing. Our component class doesn't create the instance of user service by itself, but it delegates creating of the service instance to another guy called injector. So what is injector? Injector is an object in Angular dependency injection who is responsible for creating of the objects. If to simplify it as much as possible, injector will create an instance of our dependency, user service in our case, and provide it as a constructor parameter for our component. In fact, we can even code some simplified prototype of dependency injection in order to show you that there is no magic behind it. So I will just go to my VS Code and create a scratch file. Here, let's create our service class. It is going to be user service, which has some method, let's say hi. And this method will just console log the string hi. And then let's create some component class, which has a dependency on our user service, and it should be passed via constructor. All right, so we just drop the whole this complexity, annotation, templates, whatever, and leave just classes, but the idea is the same, actually. So now here below, we gonna implement our dependency injection mechanism. So let's create first a class of our injector. Cool. Then we know that in Angular, services are actually singletons in scope of injector. And it means that we have to have some container where we will be storing our service instances, right? So if some component requests the instance of some service, we just return the existing one instead of create the new instance of this service. So I will introduce a private property called container, which is going to be the instance of the map. And if you don't know what is map, it is very similar to plain object, but it has two key differences. And the first one, it guarantees the order of keys. And the second one is that the key can be literally anything. It can be even Boolean or object. And exactly this feature we will be using here. So let's move forward. Then we need a method which will be kind of a resolver of our dependencies. So let's create a method. I will call it get. And this method takes one parameter, which I'm gonna call service, which has type any, which makes sense because I can have really any service. And then I just get the instance of our service using the service name as a key and return it. But what we have to do in case if there is no instance for this service? Well, let's throw an error in this case for now. The next problem now is that we will be always getting an error, right? Because our container is always empty for now. So let's fix it. I will create a constructor which will be taking one parameter called providers, which is going to be array of services we're going to provide. And here in constructor, we go through the array and create instances of these services and add each of them to our container. And the key of the instance will be the service class name. All right. So looks good. Our resolver is ready. So let's have a look how it would be used in the application. When Angular starts, it creates an instance of injector and paths all services which should be registered as a constructor parameter. In our case, we provide it manually, but in Angular, it happens when we use providers property in our ng-model component and directive annotation, or if we configure it via provided in property inside injectable annotation. Then when Angular creates an instance of our component, it does something like this. We use our injector in order to get an instance of our user service from dependency injection container. And after this, we can already get access to the instance of our user service and we can call its method sayHi. And as you can see, it works fine right now. If we remove a user service from provider array, we get an error that says that not provider found. And exactly this happens in Angular when we forget to provide some service, but then try to inject this in some component class. Of course, this everything is hidden from you and this magic happens during the compilation time. But once Angular compiled the application, you will see something similar to what we have right now. Not exactly this, but similar. All right, good. So I hope now you have a clear picture about how this dependency injection mechanism works. And let's move forward and talk a little bit about injectors hierarchy. Yes, Angular has not only one injector, but it creates a hierarchy of injectors, and more of it, there are two hierarchies, model injector and element injector hierarchy. Let's start with model injector. When Angular starts, it creates a root injector where will be registered our services, which we provided via injectable annotation and all services provided in ng-model property called providers, if those modules are not lazy loaded. Angular recursively goes through all modules which are being used in the application and creates instances for provided services in root injector. So if you thought that if you provide some service in some module and it will be available only in scope of this module, it is actually wrong. If you provide some service in eagerly loaded module, it will be added to the root injector, which makes it available across the whole application. But this root injector is not actually the highest in this hierarchy. During application bootstrapping, Angular creates few more injectors. Above the root injector goes platform injector. This one is being created by platform browser dynamic function inside main.ts file. And it provides some platform-specific features like, DOM sanitizer, platform ID token, and so on. And then, at the very top, there is a null injector. The responsibility of this injector is very easy. It just throws the error if something tries to find dependencies there. But let's get back to our root model injector. What about the child injectors for it? We know that another modules which we import in our root or app model, they are not creating new child injectors, and providers from them go to the root injector. But it is valid only for non-lazy modules. But modules which were loaded lazily create its own injector, which are children for our root injector. And few years ago, it could be a problem if you wanted to have a singleton service across whole app, because this child injector would create a new service instance, so you would have multiple instances of the same service. Today, we usually don't have such a problem, but sometimes you can still come across the for root pattern, which was the way how to solve this issue. Okay, cool. So that was the model injector hierarchy. Now let's talk about element injector one. Element injector is being created for any tag that matches Angular component or any tag on which directive is applied. And you can configure it in component and directive annotations inside provider's property. And it creates its own hierarchy, likewise component ones. Okay, so two hierarchies. Now the question is, how does Angular resolve dependencies? What happens when some component declares dependency in its constructor? Let's imagine that we have the next component structure, and this will be also element injector hierarchy, because we know that element injector is being created for every component or directive. Then we have a model injector hierarchy, which is represented by our null injector, platform injector, and root injector. And there will be no child injector. Let's keep it just simple for now. We declare dependency in our grandchild component and provide a service in our root application component. In this case, Angular starts traversing of element injector hierarchy first. It checks if we have the service provided in this current component where the dependency declared. If this component doesn't have it, it will ask its parent, and this one also has nothing. Then it goes up in the hierarchy and encounters our root component, and root component says that, yes, I have this token you are looking for, and our grandchild component will get the instance of the service from root component. Now let's imagine that we have the same case, but we don't provide any service. So now it looks like this. At the beginning, everything will be the same. We go up through element injector hierarchy and encounter the root element injector. Root element injector says that, hey man, sorry, I do not have what you're looking for. And then Angular goes back to the view where we started and checks in which model injector scope this component exists. In our case, it is the root model injector, and it delegates resolving further to the model injector hierarchy, starting from this model injector which our component belongs to. And here happens the same scenario. There is small hint though. if this component was a part of lazy loaded component, it would be a scope of child model injector. So Angular would start traversing the model injector tree from this child model injector. And yeah, if Angular would find the provider in our root model injector, it would inject this instance in our grandchild component. But in our case, we have nothing provided, so it will go up to the parent injector, we'll try to resolve it there, and if still nothing is found, it will reach our null injector, which throws the error. And this is the very simplified representation of how Angular dependency injection mechanism resolves dependencies. Okay guys, that was it for today. I hope you enjoyed this video and now you have better understanding of dependency injection mechanism in Angular. Of course, I'm going to cover more advanced and interesting topics regarding the Angular dependency injection in my future videos, so this is the right time to subscribe to my channel. And of course, don't forget to leave your feedback in comment section, because it allows me to improve my content for you and make it more useful and more interesting. So guys, thank you for attention. I wish you a productive week. Take care and see you in the future.